Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Neale, and I'll be doing our short message for our ReLaunch service today. We're very glad to have each and every one of you here. And today, we are going to be going through David, who we've been covering the past few weeks, who was king of Israel. He's the man who slayed Goliath. He's referred to often in the Bible as the man after God's own heart, meaning God and David were incredibly close, and David loved the Lord. He had a few mess-ups. He had a few major sins, but God in his grace covered those, and David tried to always repent and walk with the Lord, and David's life is really incredible. We see the highs and the lows. And what we're coming to today, we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 23. And we're just going to cover a few short verses. And it's kind of his last words to the people of Israel. And it's very interesting because I think some of us might relate to some of his words. And they're kind of fortuitous in their timing, but as we'll get into it. But I want to pray just real quickly, and then we'll get into our passage of scripture today. Our Father God, we just come before you now, and Father, we thank you just for everyone that's here. Father, we thank you that we can have some food and some soup that's been made and provided to us, and we just thank you for the hands that have prepared it. And Father, we just ask that you would bless this time as we look into your word. Help us to understand it. Help us to see the hope that is in you and in being part of your family. And Father, I do pray that you just bless the rest of the day and our conversations around the table as we go from here. And we would just be reminded that we know that you love us and that you care about us. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. So the verses we'll be covering are verses 2 through 4. And like I said, this is David's last words to the people of Israel. And he says in this of what the people should really be looking out for, what they should be desiring in the future. And that will come clear once we've read it. So verse 2, it starts off, "The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. His word was on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke. The Rock of Israel said to me, 'When one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he is like a light of the morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth.'" So David has tried, and he, like I said, he's had his stumblings, he's had his failures, he's had his sin, but he's tried as king of Israel most of his life to govern the people, to be a good king, and to do what he says in verse 3. He says, "One who rules in righteousness." And what does that mean? It means when he rules in the fear of God. So that means that this man who rules in the fear of God, he recognizes that even though David's king, there's someone far greater above him. And that's the God that he serves. So, and David knows that one day he will give an account for what he's done. And so he lives his life in accordance of that, knowing that David has to act justly, he has to be merciful, he has to be fair, he has to be above reproach, meaning he can't be getting into things that are questionable, which he did. He wasn't perfect by any means. He had his failings. But he tried so hard to love the Lord and to be a good king. And he was a good king. David was overall a good king of the people of Israel. But now he's saying, in his final farewell, he's saying God is speaking through him. And God has spoke through David many times in his life, and this is one of them. He says in verse 2 once again, "The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me. His word was on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke. The Rock of Israel said to me, 'When one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God.'" And this is how he describes that man, that ruler is described as this. "He is like the light of the morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after the rain that brings grass from the earth." It's someone whose rule brings forth abundance. When we think of growing plants and vegetables, My dad has just started getting into gardening for the first time in his life, and he's growing potatoes and strawberries and some other things. And everyone was away at my house for the past like over a week, and so I was firmly instructed that the moment I got home, which was yesterday, I had to water everything. And my dad was scared the entire week, everything's going to be dead. And I got there and everything was good, everything was still green, everything's still well watered, so that was good. But it's kind of remarkable how quick, if you've ever grown tatties, potatoes before, how quick they grow. I was shocked. So this is the first time my dad's ever done this, and within a couple weeks, they're already sprouting and growing at a remarkable rate. And they bring forth great abundance, these vegetables, these fruits. And this is why God's describing this ruler. It's someone, it says that right at the end of verse 4, like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth. And what is the key definition of this man? It says right there in verse 3, when he rules in the fear of God, he understands that God is the one who he needs to rule for. Understand that God helps him think, God helps him understand, God molds him by the Bible, by his word, to understand what that means to act righteously, to fear the Lord. We've got an interesting event next week. It is the election. Now, I would never personally get into politics or anything like that at church. And that is, I've always had that. But I will tell you one thing that I'm pretty certain of. No matter who wins, it's not going to be people that rule righteously in the fear of God. No matter the party, miracle, expected result, it's not going to be what God, at least the way David's describing, that it's going to be this great, great, great thing. There'll be maybe some good, some bad, as is with all politics. But the thing that makes, when I read that, and when I read this man, that David, God's speaking through David, and he's saying, this righteous ruler who puts things right. And then I think of our country, and I lived in America for 11 years, they're the same. I'm like, man, it's bad. It's not looking good. And I get kind of down, but I remember, and this is what the Bible is stressing all the time, our hope is not in this world. It's not in our elected leaders, even though we should pray for them. We should pray that they should govern righteously and fairly. But our hope is in the Lord. It's in him who is going to one day come back, and he's going to put everything right. He's going to fix all the problems. He's going to change the world completely. He's going to change creation completely so that everything is right and good and how it was supposed to be. And I just want to read real quickly one of the second last chapter of the Bible, and it talks about this time when Jesus is on this earth and he's putting everything right. And this is what our hope is in. So if you are coming to church today and you don't know God, I'm telling you, you need to put your hope in this. If you've come to church for 50 years, 20 years, 10 years, this should be your hope, the thing you look forward to, the thing you trust in. And I'll just start in verse 3. This is the book of Revelation, chapter 21, starting in verse 3. And it says, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more, neither there shall be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. There is coming a time when there'll be no more crying, because there'll be no more sadness. There'll be no more losing loved ones. There'll be no more experiencing pain. There'll be no more injustice in the world. That will be all gone. And God will be here, and he's going to make it right. It's not me and you are going to make it right, even though we are called to live in this world, to act justly, to show mercy to people, to tell people about the Lord. And this is the man who's going to be on the throne, Jesus himself, the one who died on the cross to pay for my sins and your sins. And he one day is going to be the perfect ruler who is going to rule righteously. So even though we can turn on the TV and we can read the newspaper, and you can look out on the street or see the mess of the world, wherever you see it, and you go, man, everything's so broken. And it's true. But that won't be the case forever. God is going to rule justly himself, and he's going to wipe away every tear. There will be no more suffering, and there'll be no more messed up countries and no more messed up people, me being the biggest one. And that's what our hope is in. Our hope is in the Lord. It's not in false promises we see on TV. It's not in ourselves. It's not in our family members. It's not even in good people or bad people. It's in the one who can do what he promises, which is Christ himself. So I hope today that if you have any questions about, you know, what it means to follow the Lord or know Jesus or hear his story, please come talk to me. I'd love to explain it to you. Or any of the ladies here, or as people sitting at your table who go to this church, or Jerry, he's kind of the man. But we would love to tell you about the Jesus and what he's done, not only for the world, but for you personally. Let's pray. Our Father God, I just thank you for your word, and Father, in it we see clearly that the world is a broken place, and we're all broken people, no matter our background, no matter what we struggle with, no matter what we worry about. We're all broken people, and we need your Son. We need to know that we are forgiven for our sins when we mess up. We also need to know that there's hope, and you promise so much hope, not just in this life. You promise to be with us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, to give us hope in the darkness. But Father, we look forward to that great, glorious hope one day when everything will be made right, and there'll be no more suffering, no more pain, no more disappointment. But Father, you will be here with us. And Father, so often as we think about things we struggle with, we just wish you were here. But Father, you are here. It talks about all over the Bible how your plan is to be with us. And today we have the Holy Spirit. And Father, we just ask that you would remind us of that often, that you are with us, that you are see us, that you see us in our struggling, in our needs. But also, Father, that great hope of one day when your dwelling place will truly be with us, and we will see you face to face, and everything will be good and right as you intended. So Father, just thank you for this time once again. I thank you for everyone that's here. Please bless this day now, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.